Metal Jesus here, and I am back again with Kinsey.
Hello.
Hello, and what do you got for me today?
Today we have 9 more Nintendo DS hidden gems, mm-hmm. plus some honorable mentions.
Awesome. Let's take a look. Alright, so what do you have to show me?
Alright, first up, we have SCARS, or as you call it...
SCARS!
I don't think anybody calls it that, but whatever, it's fun regardless.
You can make the argument, I'm just saying.
It is a kind of an action racer, where mm-hmm. it's kind of based, well, on racing, yeah. and on kind of destroying your opponent with items.
Yeah, so very similar to like Mario Kart, and you know, yeah. we have different power-ups and... And I really like the hopping mechanic, you know, where you hop over, you know.
Yeah, because if someone puts out a weird electric fence, you can jump over it if yeah. you timed it right.
Yeah.
So it kind of gives a new dynamic where, yeah, you can get around these things if you're good at it.
And you and I, we're having a lot of fun playing this multiplayer.
Yeah, I think I won with my shark card.
Dude, I was just going to say, I think I won. I don't know, you know. It's been a while since we played it, so.
And all the cars are based off animals, which is kind of awesome.
Definitely, definitely cool.
All right, next up, we have Pokemon Snap. And I know a lot of people might not think this is a hidden gem, but, I mean, I was telling you about it, and you had never played it.
No, not. I think I'd heard of it, but I know that it's so different than the normal Pokemon, you know, card battling thing. So.
Yeah, definitely in this era, Pokemon was big on Pokemon Stadium, or the Game Boy games. So, like, I mean, as we mentioned in the last episode, Pokemon Puzzle League and Pokemon Snap, I feel like, got a little bit left behind.
Mm-hmm. And actually watching you play this was really fun because, again, you're kind of moving through this 3D environment and what are you doing? You're like throwing stuff at the different...
Well, it's kind of like a rail shooter in a way. You're taking pictures of Pokemon and you're graded on how well your pictures turn out. But you can also manipulate the environment by throwing apples or pester balls.
Right.
Or you can also use the Poke Flute on certain Pokemon, and which is cool because it can unlock like different evolutions that you can get pictures of that you wouldn't otherwise be able to do, or unlock passageways to a different level.
Yeah, this game is way more in depth than I ever imagined. I was watching you play it because, well, you've mastered it like 100% or something like that. Like, you knew where all this little hidden stuff was. It was really cool to watch.
My only disappointment about this game is that it does not have 151 Pokemon in it. That was my only disappointment, but I don't know if I'm alone in that.
Okay. So the next game is called Hybrid Heaven. And I actually captured the footage for this game. It was pretty fun, I thought.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's very different.
Yeah, you start off kind of like a third-person shooter kind of action, but then, and this is where I think this game excels, is that in combat, it's like a fighting RPG.
Yeah, it's like fighting moves, but in a turn-based style, which is kind of cool because no other game does that on this system. Well, not only on this system, but I don't know if many other games do that in general.
Yeah, I've never heard of anything like this. So you basically choose like high or low punches, you choose counters, what was it, like guarding, stuff like that. I mean, it was actually pretty strategic. It was cool.
Yeah, and it has a pretty fun two-player battle mode too.
Now, I mean, the game itself is not the most like attractive looking, although it does have the naked guy in the beginning of it.
It does have some male nudity in the shower with some steam. Worth it. Just saying.
I don't even know where to go after that.
I don't think any other game has male nudity on the 64.
Probably not.
All right, next up we have Gex 64, Enter the Gecko. And I actually love this game, and I love all the Gex games. Mm. But this one is super cool. It's a kind of a parody of, like, TV and our consumer culture, which is kind of awesome. Like, the very first episode you go into is based on, like, Saturday morning cartoons, at least in the 90s. And so you instantly start off in, like, a rabbit suit, and there's, like, this weird, like, Elmer Fudd type character, like, chasing after you. So
oh, interesting.
It's
okay.
Kind of awesome.
Bugs Bunny.
Yeah.
Huh.
And they also have, like a spoof on the Titanic chorus and like Jack Cousteau and a lot of spoofs on kung fu movies. So this game's awesome. It is a 3D platformer like most games on the system, but I love this game.
That's cool. I need to play that game. So next up is Disney's Tarzan. You introduced me to this game.
And this game is actually pretty awesome.
Yeah.
It's kind of like one of those 2.5D platformers, and it plays actually very much like Donkey Kong Country.
Yeah, I mean, it looks pretty impressive. I thought it was really fun. I mean,
it's super fun. Don't be like, oh, but it's a Disney movie game. Like, don't worry about it. It's super fun. You do the standard collecting letters throughout the levels. Has a couple other collection things, and
well, you know, I mean, back in the especially the NES time, I mean, Disney games were actually really good. Like
Aladdin.
Yeah, and yeah. Lion King. Yeah, mm-hmm. And then also Mickey Mouse. I mean, there was a bunch of great Mickey Mouse.
Oh, so many good Mickey Mouse games.
Yeah, totally. So this is really cool to get on the N64.
Yeah, it's kind of a reminiscent of that time period, mm-hmm. actually. So this is like one of the last really good movie games. So. Yeah. All right, and next up we have Rocket Robot on Wheels.
Yes.
And you actually played a decent amount of this for the capture.
I did.
Capture.
So first of all, this is a Sucker Punch game, and they are local to Seattle.
Mm-hmm.
And they make a bunch of great games like Infamous. They also make the Sly Cooper games. But I want to say this is one of their first games, and it's actually pretty cool. I mean, you're this little robot.
It's really fun.
Yeah. You have this like one wheel. You're cruising around in like a 3D environment. And it seems like there's a bunch of variety. I haven't gotten really far into the game, but there's race courses, a bunch of platforming. I don't know. It seems like you can see that they are a high-quality developer with this game.
Yeah, they put a lot of thought into this, and mm-hmm. it shows. It's really fun.
Definitely.
All right, and next up, we have Tonic Trouble, which is by the same people who make Rayman.
Mm.
And I don't know which came first, because they came out super close together. But this plays very much the same way. He has like...
Yeah, like his arms are kind of detached.
Yeah,
or,
he can detach himself and all of that. But it's actually really fun. It has a really cute kind of storyline that goes with it. Mm-hmm. He's an alien that drops a tonic on Earth, and he has to go down and kind of remedy his mistakes because it kind of made everything turn into enemies, like the vegetables and the animals and like everything. Yeah. It makes a Viking take over, so it's kind of cool.
This was fun to watch, actually.
Yeah.
I'm really surprised that this didn't take off quite like Rayman. I mean, I don't know why that happened, right?
Yeah.
Maybe they just decided that Rayman was going to be their mascot, but this is actually a pretty decent little game.
It's pretty fun, and it's kind of like quirky and silly, like mm-hmm. most, like a lot of the platformers, but it's definitely worth a try, especially at this price point, because it's not very expensive.
Yeah, totally.
And next up, we have one of my favorites on the system, which is Chameleon Twist. It has a little bit of a weird, like, controller scheme. That was people's biggest complaint about it.
That's like a lot of N64 games.
Yeah, you know? I mean, it's kind of weird, but mm-hmm. once you realize, like, how to play and you get into it, it's really fun. It has some really cool dynamics. I mean, you're a chameleon, and they play a lot on, like, a chameleon's tongue. You can, like, use it almost like a hookshot mm-hmm. in Zelda.
Yeah.
You can grab onto things, and you can like spin around them at that length, or you can zoom up and go to them. So
it reminded me of Minish Cap a little bit, mm-hmm. And how that sort of like hooking mechanic works, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
It's super fun.
Yeah, cool. All
right, and last up, we have Xena, based off the TV show.
Which actually, when you chose this game, I was like, oh my god.
No, just
like, no. Well, no, actually, because I think you told me, like, Bruce Campbell, isn't it? Like, his character, you know, the thief or whatever?
Yep.
I was like, oh, I gotta play as Bruce Campbell, yes!
It's pretty awesome. Not very many, like, fighting games allow you, like, four players. You can split up teams if you want. Mm. It just has a really cool dynamic that they put with it.
Yeah, you and I actually had a lot of fun playing this.
It's so fun.
I think you probably destroyed me again.
I did. As Gabrielle, too. So, definitely worth it to check out. Another, like, one of the many games on the 64 that's not very expensive. And, I mean, four-player fighting game. Like, it's awesome.
Oh, yeah, totally. Actually, the N64 was really good at four-player, sitting on the couch, multiplayer.
There are so many multiplayer games that were amazing. That's probably the system when I was younger that I played the most multiplayer games for. It's so good.
And, you know, I didn't actually realize that until you came over and we started capturing the footage for all these games because it was so much fun. And it sort of like...
It was a blast.
Yeah, the light came off. It's like, oh my god. It's like we spent hours doing that. It's so cool.
It's awesome.
Yeah, definitely.
It's worth it.
All right, well, that is our second video of Hidden Gems, but I'm kind of curious about some of the accessories that came with the N64.
The 64 had lots of accessories.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the one people most know is the Rumble Pack.
So what's really weird about this is that games will prompt me to insert it, right?
Yeah.
So I guess it's because the controller didn't have it obviously built in. So if the game, like, supported Rumble Pack, you're supposed to, like, stop everything, pop it out, you know.
Yep. Like, are you sure you want to continue without the Rumble Pack? And you're like,
yeah.
I guess so.
Yeah, I think it's okay. I know. I never actually use it, really, because...
I did when I was younger. I always wanted to use the Rumble Pack.
Oh.
I was like, oh, it's so cool, it rumbles. But they actually originally sold it bundled with Star Fox.
Oh, really?
Which really utilized it. So that was a good way to kind of jump off the selling point of the Rumble Pack.
Now, you have to put your own batteries in it, though, right?
Yeah.
Is that like a good thing? You're like, hell yeah!
Two triple A's?
Oh.
Oh, man.
So many jokes I could go there, but I'm not going to. So you had to put your own batteries in it, which is actually pretty interesting. So.
Yeah, I think it worked for and against them, I guess. Because if you didn't have the batteries, it probably wouldn't have the same power.
Yeah.
Or might not do anything. I'm not really sure how the mechanics of the 64 controller work, but...
Well, that's cool.
Yeah.
And then, when I got my very first N64, I couldn't play a couple games because I didn't have this.
Yeah, you need the expansion pack for Donkey Kong 64 and Majora's Mask.
Okay.
You have to have it.
Yeah.
And then, like, Perfect Dark, it's super limited unless you have it.
Yeah.
Then a couple other games, like in StarCraft 64, it unlocks, like, the Brood Wars level or something like that. And then a couple other games, it enhances the graphics. So it's... definitely worth it if you want to play a lot of these 64 games.
Now, is it hard to find now, or is it seems?
I've kind of heard that it's not necessarily hard to find, but it's gone up in value a lot.
Oh, okay.
So it's a little bit pricier than it used to be.
And then, of course, you have the memory card, right?
Oh, the memory cards. The 64 was one of those systems where. Like, the PlayStation, I thought about memory cards because you couldn't save without them.
Right.
But if you played Mario Kart, Banjo-Kazooie, first-party games, you didn't need a memory card on the 64 because they all had save batteries.
Okay.
So you would just get this, not first-party game, and then you're like, I'm going to play this and it's going to be a great night. Oh, memory card. So it kind of happened on kind of the more, random games, and I was never really prepared for it as a kid.
Yeah.
I know now. So get a memory card, people. You'll need it.
And one of the things that actually kind of threw me off is that you had to insert it into the controller.
Yeah,
which again,
goes into the controller.
Yeah, which I was kind of like, what? And again, the PlayStation, you put it right into the console, which makes sense to me, in the controller. So how did that work if you had a memory card and the Rumble Pack?
See, you can't put them both in there.
Right.
So a lot of third-party developers made a combo Rumble and memory.
Oh.
Nintendo never really made one, as far as I know. But a lot of third party did because you couldn't do both.
Okay, interesting. Well, very cool. And this has been an awesome series of videos, but we're not going to end there, right? We're actually going to have some honorable mentions.
Of course.
Of course. Well, thanks for coming on.
Of course. It's been a blast.
Let us know what you think in the comments below. And as always, I want to thank you for watching my channel and thank you for subscribing.
Thanks.
Take care. So I'm gonna wrap it up here, and then I'll mention.
See, you're learning stuff.
I'm gonna feather my hair. That'd be awesome.